Hi there, my name is Jared Green. I am a longtime veteran of the art and auction industry. I've worked for Heritage Auctions and Live Auctioneers, two of the largest players in the art and auction world. I served as senior officer in both companies and as vice president and senior vice president. And I've spent over 20 years in the art and auction business. I wanted to create this series to talk with people about the auction world, answer some questions, and over the course of this series, talk to some of the professionals in the auction industry about where they excel and maybe some pitfalls to look out for as you're navigating as a buyer or a seller. I typically work with high net worth individuals, family offices, trust and estate attorneys, and even interior designers who have clients who are circulating art in and out of their collections with new designs or buying, say, a new property or a building that they want to embellish with nice art. And I'm always a big fan of looking for investment grade art. One of the things I typically say to clients who are looking for art, and friends in particular, is if you're going to spend less than, say, $2,000 on a piece of art, buy something you love. Just do it. You know, if it's not going to make that much of an impact on your monthly budget or your annual fund budget, buy it. But if you're looking for art to hold its value, then you actually have to do some investigating and figure out whether that piece of artwork is going to hold its value. So we have two different types of markets. We have the primary market and the secondary market for art and rarity. The primary market would be making a purchase directly from a gallery. A new artist, an emerging artist, or even an existing artist who's putting out new work. That's the primary market. The secondary market is perhaps you go into a dealer shop, you go onto eBay, art platforms like Artsy, or an auction house purchase. And you buy a piece that has been owned by someone previously, which is actually how I love to buy art and collectibles, because I actually believe in finding a lot of value by purchasing through the secondary markets. Occasionally I'll find a piece, prospecting new artists that I'm interested in, and I'll purchase through the primary market. But secondary market is my strength and my area of expertise. Not all auction houses are created equal. There are over 8,000 auction houses throughout the world. Most of them are US-based, and they deal with handling the estates of families and individuals. And these are what we would call primarily regional auction houses. They don't tend to have multiple locations. There's usually a single office. The larger players, and these are limited to probably the top 100 auction houses. These are auction houses that tend to do about 5 million plus a year in auction sales. A lot of these auction houses have multiple locations in major cities. They also have niche departments focused on different areas of collecting. Auction houses like Heritage Auctions have a fine art department, but then also break it down into illustration art. They have collectibles departments, including comic book art and movie poster art. They have a sports card and sports collectibles division. So all those are considerations you'll want to be aware of as a collector, trying to figure out where to buy your materials, buy collectibles. Sometimes I like to go to lesser known auction houses to value seek. I look for places where everyone else is not looking for a great find, and occasionally I pick up something at a great value. And then we can talk about selling later, but what I tend to do is I tend to move pieces from market to market or auction house to auction house, unless I have a private collector who's interested in that piece. A lot of times I make these finds and I'll bring them to an appropriate niche sale. So for example, if I buy a Mickey Mantle rookie card at a regional auction house that is selling the baseball card as a component of an estate they're selling, that's not necessarily focused on rarities or sports cards, but just liquidating an estate. And I then take that card over to an auction house like, say, Hakes, which is known for retro collectibles. I'm more likely to get a better premium from that niche sale because I have more eyeballs looking at that sale for sports collectibles than I did in that regional auction house sale. And this is one of the ways that I play the market. I'm able to buy and sell and make a premium by doing such sales. I also like to shop for good quality items. And these niche sales are great for buying quality items that have been expertised. If there's ever a question of provenance on a piece, I would much rather buy from a large auction house that has something on the line if the item turns out not to be authentic than to buy from a regional auction house that really doesn't have any skin in the game. These are all considerations for buying from an auction house. One of the most valuable tools that I use when prospecting art is a want list. I find that actually, my former employee, Live Auctioneers, has one of the best want list tools that exists in the industry. A want list is pretty simple. You go in and you list the names of the artists or the types of works that you're looking for, whether it's Jadro or Hummel, which I don't necessarily recommend, or it's important artists like Andy Warhol. Original works or prints, you make notation of that in your want list and you create your list. And then, as new pieces are added by different auction houses, I'd say over 8,000 auction houses use Live Auctioneers as a listing engine for marketing their sales, you get an email in your inbox notifying you that certain items have showed up in your want list. I do this on a daily basis. I'm always looking for items that are of interest. And I probably bid on 10 times the number of items than I actually win. I know what I'm willing to pay, and I try not to let my desire win over my common sense. That's a big thing in the collectibles industry, is to understand what you're willing to spend on an item before you start bidding. I use different tools for figuring out what to pay for an item and what's a safe price. One of the best tools I use is price comparables from auction sales. AskArt.com is a great subscription service. ArtNet.com is a great subscription service. Live Auctioneers has a free auction comparable database if you're signed up as a member, which is also free. I believe Invaluable also has a price comparable database. But basically what I do is I look up the item, I see when a similar item was last sold, and I try to deduce what the value should be in the current market for that item. And this is how I make a purchase decision. As comparables start to go up for a particular artist's work, I might start thinking to myself, now would be a good time to sell. At that point, I start looking for niche sales. So for example, if I have a piece of comic art, or let's say psychedelic art, which I love, and urban art, let's say there's an urban art sale, and I note that the price of, say, Jeff Soto's work, which is over my shoulder, this robot. Jeff Soto's work is starting to increase in price. So I get in touch with the department head and let them know that I have a Soto original painting that I'd like to enter into the sale. And we discuss reserves. So they might say, we expect to estimate this piece at between $3,000 and $5,000. If I agree with that, I say yes. If I don't, I may walk away and say, no, I'm not interested yet. When the estimates are higher, then maybe I'll consider it. But typically, the goal of a department head is to get the piece sold. So they're going to be fair with you on auction estimates, but also try to create demand for your piece at auction. So if the estimate looks like a deal, sometimes it's to impress upon the collector that here's an opportunity, a great buying opportunity. So I would say if you trust the auction specialist that you're dealing with, go along with it. Accept that they know more about this industry than you do, but sometimes you also have to hold your ground if you know the market particularly well. A reserve is the minimum price that you will allow your painting to be sold for. In general, and I have always been coached on this, stay away from reserves. One thing, you don't want to have a painting come back to you. If the painting doesn't sell at auction, it's quote unquote burned. It means that collectors in the field and dealers have seen the painting go up for sale and it didn't sell. So it takes away some of the interest in the work.